Have on that? Ready? Good evening, everyone. It's Thursday, October 13th at 7 p.m. This is a meeting of the Bellbrook-Sugarcreek Board of Education in public for the purpose of conducting the school district's business. It's not to be considered a public community meeting, but there is a time for public participation during the meeting as indicated on the agenda. Mr. Lyman, will you please call the roll?
Mr. Carpenter?
Here.
Mrs. Dorn?
Here.
Mr. Kinsey?
Present.
Mr. Price?
Here.
Mrs. Anderson?
Here.
Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Mr. Lyman, please give the treasurer's report.
Okay, can I get a motion to approve the minutes from the September 8th, September 19th, and September 26th meetings as included with the agenda?
So.
Mrs. Dorn?
Second.
Mr. Kinsey?
Regarding that, I'll have to abstain for the 19th. I wasn't here unplanned, but I was not here on the 19th. So how do you want to break it out?
Do you want to break it out, or do you want to abstain for all three?
Yeah, you can, we can pull that one.
Well, no, actually, I would like to approve.
On that.
Especially September 8th.
Okay, so we will not include September 19th on that, on this motion. So please call the roll for approval of September 8th and 26th.
Mr. Carpenter?
Yes.
Mrs. Dorn?
Yes.
Mr. Kinsey?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mrs. Anderson?
Yes.
Motion passes. Do I have a motion to approve the minutes from September 19th?
So.
Mrs. Dorn?
Second.
And Mr. Kinsey? Any questions or comments? All right, Mr. Lyman, please call the roll.
Okay, Mr. Carpenter?
Yes.
Mrs. Dorn?
Yes.
Mr. Kinsey?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Same.
And Mrs. Anderson?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Okay, can I
catch up on that?
Yes, thank you. Could I get a motion to approve the treasurer's report for the month of September?
So moved.
Mrs. Anderson?
Second.
Mrs. Dorn? Okay, go ahead.
I just want to say one thing before I start on the report itself, and that is that, we are auditing every year, and as I mentioned before, it costs about $20,000 to $25,000. We have to pay for our own audit, and this year I've not heard from them at all. And everyone that I knew that was in audit has resigned. So I just go sit back and wait till they contact me for the audit, I guess. Normally, middle of September or beginning of October is when they start auditing, and they contact me a week or two ahead of time, but they're having such staffing problems, like a lot of industry right now, that I don't know, seriously considering, I think I mentioned it in this meeting before, but I'm seriously considering going with a CPA firm to do our audits, which is our choice now. You have to stay with the state for a certain number of years, and you can transition to a CPA firm if you so desire. You apply to do that, and we are at that point. I think that's what I'm going to do. It's totally different audit, and there's good and bad of each. But I think I'm going to switch. I just thought I'd bring that up. I don't know if it matters that much. The cost is about the same, and there are differences in quality, amount of time that the group is in our building, how many auditors are on site, and how many times they leave and come back. Because a lot of times the state has to leave and come back, they're doing like four different audits at the same time, and there's a big problem in one district, and they all leave for a couple weeks. Then they come back, and it's really disjointed and difficult to, flow through that without, it's like being interrupted in a classroom. It's just tough, so thought I'd mention that. There's really not a whole lot with the financial reports that stuck out, nothing, no large expenditures or receipts that weren't expected. But I did want to say that in the fiscal year, these reports are as of the end of September, and that would be July or September, 3 months into the fiscal year, so exactly 25% of the fiscal year has expired. And so I always like to look at these reports, like I review each, pretty much each meeting, and see where we are on the, it would be the first page of the blue copy. Percentages to the right show what percentage, for instance, real estate taxes, what percentage of what I budgeted for the year has come in already. And I, as I mentioned occasionally, 46% has come in already. That doesn't mean we're receiving way more than expected. It just means that we recently got one of our two big real estate settlements. So we won't get any money for several months, and that'll wind up getting down to a more reasonable percentage that makes sense. We are, with 25% expired, we're right where we want to be for salaries, benefits, and state foundation receipts, pretty much there at the same place. So, any questions on any of the reports that I've included for me? These are on the website also.
Thank you.
Thanks to Henry.
Thanks, Henry.
Thank you, Henry. All right, any questions, comments? All right, Mr. Lyman, please call the roll.
Okay. Mrs. Dorn?
Yes.
Mr. Kinsey?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mrs. Anderson?
Yes.
And Mr. Carpenter?
Yes. Motion passes.
Okay, and then request the establishment of a student activity account, fund number 200-9100, for establishment of a Bellbrook High School Art Club for the this school year, at the request of Mr. Hamm.
Okay. Do we have a motion?
So moved.
Mrs. Anderson?
Second.
Mr. Kinsey? Questions or more thoroughly comments? All right, no other questions? Okay, please call the roll.
Mr. Kinsey?
Yes.
Mrs. Price? Mr. Price?
Say again.
Mrs. Anderson?
Yes.
Mr. Carpenter?
Yes.
And Mrs. Dorn?
Yes.
And Mr. Price? Yes.
Oh, and just, gosh, really?
I said say again.
Motion passes. Okay, going on to the correspondence. Anyone have correspondence that they wanted to be able to share some highlights from, or any comments about correspondence which you received? All right. We'll go on to open communication. And Mrs. Dorn is getting the list, and thank you very much for that. Couple items from our policy on public participation, just as a reminder, these are not different, thank you. That when community members get up to speak, they're to share their name and address, and also that speakers are to address the presiding officer, which is me this evening, and not reach out to question other board members or speak directly to other board members. So direct the comments to me. All right. So this evening we have one person signed up, Cassie Kipling on McPhee. Thank you.
Do I should state my address again? Is that what you said?
Yes, please.
Yeah, I live on 936 McPhee Road in Bellbrook. So I haven't got a comment on one of these in a while. So tonight I want to talk about communication. The past couple board meetings I've watched online, and I've been very frustrated watching online. We're officially a quarter of the way through our 22-23 academic school year. And there's been a severe lack of communication from the board to the community. It's not good. Last year, you ensured the community that would be at least made aware of what you're considering. For weeks, you allowed the community to debate both sides of the issue, fifthly regarding masks. You talked topics to death before making a decision. We're not seeing that now. Unfortunately, this is not the case with regarding the passage of the task force. I think it's technically three board meetings ago. You spent less than an hour discussing this topic in public before voting to institute a task force. Where was the opportunity for the actual open communication to discuss the motion? I, for one, am not comfortable with bringing guns into a school. The idea of having guns in a school to keep guns out of the school, it doesn't make sense to me. But the thing I'm not okay with is having the words active shooter being plastered on the sides of an elementary building. After these sites were posted, I emailed each of you. I had one board member reply to me very quickly. It was very, very clearly a copy and paste response from other emails. That board member was at least respectful enough to engage in follow-up emails, and to a point where I challenged some of the talking points, and I got replied with a reply that said, thanks for the follow-up. Communication ended. And another email response from another board member, it was suggested that if I had a better idea of what the signs should say, then I should share those ideas. The time for that type of discussion is before the signs are posted, not after. I should not have to point out to each of you that the words active shooter around young children should not be used when we don't even use those words for safety drills or lockdown drills. It is for the sake of their mental health that we don't use these words. Many parents didn't want children to wear masks last year for the sake of their mental health, which was discussed at length. So why are we not talking about the ramifications of sign verbiage on young children? There was one board member that was kind enough to respond to me after 2 weeks that let me know that the sign verbiage had changed. Why are we not hearing from the school board president and the school board vice president on these matters? I have not received any feedback, and it's appalling. Many parents have also noticed the same thing. At the end of the last school board meeting, you allowed time for open communication, but as soon as the last individual concluded their comments, the meeting was immediately adjourned. There was zero discussion on the information presented to the board. Mr. Eric Price discussed his background with training individuals to handle active shooter scenarios. He presented you with a counter argument to what you had heard at previous board meetings. He didn't even acknowledge that perhaps an alternate view should be heard. I would like to propose a motion. I know I'm not a board member, but I'd like to propose a motion for the community or the board to consider. Any new motion brought forth by the school board that could potentially impact the safety of our children, mental or physical, needs to be discussed openly at one board meeting and not voted on until the following board meeting. The community deserves the right to provide you with their concerns prior to a motion being passed. The way that the board went about passing the active shooter response team and the installing of the signs that each school had on them was completely irresponsible.
Thank you. All right, we have no other individuals signed up for open communication. Going on to new business, we have items 6A and 6B, including a hand carrying item, which includes the certified license, staff employment, resignation, leave of absence, and supplemental duties for certified and licensed staff, and then support staff employment, resignation, and leave of absence. Do you want to briefly comment on the hand carried?
Sure. So, the camp advisor, there was one last person compared to what was on the original one, so that's why the percents changed there. So that's the change there. And then also Steve Nuttall for high school custodian for third shift was a late add from the original paperwork. So,
all right.
Those are the two additions on the hand carry.
All right, thank you very much. So board members, is there any item that you would like to have pulled from the consent agenda and addressed separately? All right. Hearing none, then do I have a motion to approve the consent agenda, which is all of item 6A, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9, and consent, and item 6B, 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5.
Move to accept.
Mr. Kinsey?
Second.
And Mrs. Dorn? Any questions or comments? All right, Mr. Liming, please call the roll.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mrs. Anderson?
Yes.
Mr. Carpenter?
Yes.
Mrs. Dorn?
Yes.
Mr. Kinsey?
Yes.
Motion passes. Hey, Dr. Kozak, you?
Yeah, C, resolution on substitute teachers. So I will quickly read this, this isn't too long here. So whereas the Bellbrook-Sugarcreek Local School Board, I'm sorry, Local School District Board of Education, Board of Education anticipates that the district may experience difficulty obtaining substitute teachers during the 22 and 23 school year. And whereas pursuant to the authority granted in Section 4 of Senate Bill 1, which is enacted by the 134th General Assembly and became effective as an emergency measure on October 28, 2021, the Board of Education was authorized to establish its own educational requirements for individuals to serve as substitute teachers during the 21-22 school year. And whereas the General Assembly has extended this authority for the 22-23 and 23-24 school years through enactment of House Bill 583, whereas the Board of Education desires to temporarily adopt modified educational requirements for substitute teachers in accordance with the law during the 22-23 and 23-24 school year as a measure to help ensure availability of a sufficient number of substitute teachers, now therefore be resolved by the Bellbrook-Sugarcreek Local School District Board of Education as follows. As follows, the Board of Education temporarily authorizes employment of substitute teachers who do not hold post-secondary degrees as otherwise required pursuant to Ohio law and regulations, including Ohio Revised Code 3319.226 and 3319.30, Ohio Administrative Code Section 3301-23-44 and or Board Policy 3120.04, employment of substitutes during the 22-23 and 23-24 school years. In addition to fulfilling the education requirements adopted by the Board of Education, an individual must be of good moral character, must have completed all required criminal background checks, as well as obtained a valid non-renewable temporary substitute teacher license issued by the Ohio Department of Education to serve as a substitute teacher in the district.
All right, we have a motion to approve.
Can we have discussion first?
The motion.
Okay.
Motion first, yeah.
Okay. So moved.
All right, Mrs. Dorn?
Second.
Mrs. Anderson? All right, there we go.
Okay.
Great.
So is there, what, why are we currently, we don't have this in place currently, correct?
No, we do currently in this, in this past school year, so what we essentially did.
So this is just an extension of what we're already doing?
Yeah, so essentially it's, we're allowing those that have a two-year degree or the equivalent to be on the list to be substitutes.
Okay.
So this really is helpful, especially with our student teachers who in the past sometimes already had a four-year degree and were doing their educational work as a master's degree, especially when I say they shifted that to all four-year degrees now. So under the old rules, they wouldn't be able to substitute for their student, for their cooperating teacher, not for other teachers. But if the cooperating teacher is not there, they're able to substitute. So for something like this, that this resolution, they would be allowed to substitute for their cooperating teacher, even though they don't have a four-year degree. But so that's one piece of it. The other piece of it is we're allowing those that have a two-year degree or the equivalent to be eligible to be a substitute. Again, they got to fill the paperwork, Mrs. Sigmund interviews them, and then we go forth from there.
Okay, so we do require the two-year degree, though.
Or the equivalent.
Some districts are not requiring that.
It's up to any, it's up to each individual district of what they want to do.
But we are requiring at least a two-year degree.
Two-year degree or the equivalent.
Okay.
Correct.
Okay, thank you.
You don't have to specify that here. I mean, you don't have to say two-year degree or equivalent because it doesn't, it just says not have a post-secondary degree.
Correct.
Okay.
Any other questions or comments? All right, Mr. Liming, please call the roll.
Mrs. Anderson?
Yes.
Mr. Carpenter?
Yes.
Mrs. Dorn?
Yes.
Mr. Kinsey?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Payment in lieu of transportation, non-public private schools. Recommend approve the modified motion number 22-101, July 14th to 22, to add the following non-public private school for payment in lieu of transportation services for students attending during the 22-23 school year. due to the impracticality of providing school district transportation per ORC 3327.02B, Hillel Academy.
Do we have a motion? Mr. Kinsey?
Second.
Mrs. Dorn? Any questions or comments?
Where is that located?
You know what, I do not know.
Somewhere in the state of Ohio.
I think it's downtown.
Is it over by NCR?
I know it has a Dayton address.
Yeah, I think it's over by NCR, but I'm not 100% sure. It is not around this, you know, south of Dayton area.
Any other questions or comments?
Is this typically for children with special needs? Is that?
Nope.
Not necessarily.
Now, this is just a board is adding new schools to the list, correct? We haven't previously had a student attend the school.
Yep.
And it's a pretty lengthy list right now.
Yep. So this, again, this doesn't have anything to do necessarily with special ed at all.
Okay, all right.
Any other questions or comments? All right, Mr. Lyman, please call the roll.
Mr. Carpenter?
Yes.
Mrs. Dorn?
Yes.
Mr. Kinsey?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mrs. Anderson?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Pay in lieu of transportation, student eligibility. So recommend approval, listing of district non-public private students, school students eligible to payment, to receive payment in lieu of transportation services for the 22-23 school year based on the practicality of transportation. That list is included in your packet.
Do you accept? So, Mr. Kinsey?
Second.
And Mrs. Dorn? Thank you. Get to that list. Questions or comments? All right, Mr. Lyman, please call the roll.
Mrs. Dorn?
Yes.
Mr. Kinsey?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mrs. Anderson?
Yes.
Mr. Carpenter?
Yes. Motion passes.
Bellbrook High School indoor track participation. Recommend approval of the 2023 high school indoor track and field participation activities. You see them listed there all the way from Audubon University to the state championships in Geneva on March 4th.
Do we have a motion?
So moved.
Mrs. Dorn?
Second.
Mrs. Anderson? Questions or comments? All right, Mr. Lyman, please call the roll.
Mr. Kinsey?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mrs. Anderson?
Yes.
Mr. Carpenter?
Yes.
Mrs. Dorn?
Yes.
Motion passes.
Recommend acceptance of the following donation with gratitude. Bellbrook Optimist Club, $500 cash donation for the purchase of high school music department concert gowns and tuxes.
Do we have a motion to approve?
So moved.
Mrs. Anderson?
Second.
Mrs. Dorn? Questions or comments?
Thank you much.
Yes, thank you very, very much.
I'll say, as somebody who graduated in 1998 and I was in a show choir, I guess that was a while ago, but we were wearing tuxes for probably the late 70s, you know, 20 years later. So thank you very much. I can relate to this and appreciate it.
For not making our students wear 1970s.
I'm not saying that we are here. I'm just saying my personal experience was we had very old tuxes that were very dated.
Why?
Yeah.
Why so? Yeah.
Yeah, the rivals did.
Yeah, the rivals. To refresh those is good.
It was definitely Cumberbund territory, though.
All right, Mr. Lyman, please call the roll.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mrs. Anderson?
Yes.
Mr. Carpenter?
With gratitude, yes.
Mrs. Dorn?
Yes.
Mr. Kinsey?
Yes.
Motion passes. Do you have any items for information or discussion? I'm not aware of any.
Yes, I have a couple. On September 22nd or 23rd, there was a great coverage on, I believe, WDTN of the Hope Squad from the middle school. Mm. And it was also listed on our Facebook page. And subsequent to that, I had some communication with Ms. Burnham, who I believe heads it up at the middle school. And I asked her, I know we, again, a lot of water's gone under the bridge for a lot of different reasons over the last year or two, but I'm trying to remember our discussion or whatever we had with respect to that expanding onto the high school. And of course, right now, it's just at the middle school. And I would really like to learn more about that. I would like, you know, if we can agree on that here, to have her come out or someone that, you know, administered that program, come out at one of our upcoming board meetings and let's open up the discussion about what it would take, you know, to support that going to the high school as well. Mm-hmm. And for those of you that don't know, it's essentially a focus, program that focuses on mental health, but I think the ultimate goal is to prevent, you know, suicide. So I think it would be, well, we would be well served to consider how we can encourage that and expand that, you know, beyond just the middle school. Because certainly high schoolers have every bit as much of a challenge as the middle schoolers do. So if that sounds acceptable, you know, without a motion here or whatever, can we consider having her come out at the, one of the upcoming board meetings, either end of October or preferably in November, and talk just a little bit more about that? Would that be acceptable to the board members here?
It'd be fine by me.
Absolutely.
And if we haven't already, make sure we bring in Mr. Hand on this conversation.
Okay, yes, yeah, for sure. Again, so if it kind of refresh all of our memories about the actual program itself, but also talk about, you know, potential expansion of it as well. So.
Thank you, Jose.
Yep, I can take that.
Thank you very much.
If that happened.
Additionally, I have a statement I would like to read here this evening. And here we go. I'd like to make a statement regarding the final resolution of the legal matter involving Superintendent Kozad related to the 2019 levy. This statement is mine and mine alone as an individual board member. My statement has not been coordinated with other board members in any way, nor does it reflect a board position on this matter. To begin, I believe it's essential for the community to look beyond the surface level of the superintendent's Alford plea and consider the full context and background of this matter. It's very important to understand that the state of Ohio is solely responsible for a highly dysfunctional K-12 public funding model that forces most school districts in Ohio to be overly and heavily reliant on property taxes for their school's funding. This dysfunctional funding system by design requires periodic local property tax levies to be passed, which inherently creates school system financial uncertainty and disproportionately and unfairly impacts our community members on fixed or limited incomes. When levies do not pass, as happens frequently, school districts face the real risk of entering what is known as fiscal emergency status, which results in state takeover of those districts. Further, it should be considered that the Auditor of State, Ohio Attorney General, and other Ohio government offices have failed and continue to fail to provide specific guidance from what school districts can and cannot say or do in communicating with their communities regarding levies, which, again, must periodically be passed to fund most K-12 school systems in Ohio. The harsh reality is that the state of Ohio, by design, paints school districts and communities into a corner with respect to their school's funding. On one hand, the state will threaten to take over school systems when financial difficulties arrive due to levy failures, yet will simultaneously watchdog them to make sure they don't cross the nebulous line and be seen as advocating for levy passage. While there is gray in interpreting the statutes that prohibit use of public funds to promote a levy, for reasons known only to the Auditor of State's office, they chose to move forward with unprecedented criminal charges on this matter within the Bellbrook-Sugarcreek School District alone. Other school districts have used the same or similar language as that contained in the 2019 postcard and other levy-related communication, which was ultimately a primary basis for the charge to which the superintendent made the Alford plea. It should be remembered that the language deemed unacceptable by the Auditor of State was only present in mailings and communication in the first failed levy attempt in May of 2019. In the three subsequent levy attempts, up to and including when the levy finally passed in May of 2021, acceptable language was apparently used as no complaints were made by the Auditor of State. So clearly, the superintendent learned from any mistakes he made in the messaging with the first levy attempt. Ultimately, this matter was about communication regarding the levy and a seemingly arbitrary subjective assessment by the Auditor of State that a gray line had been passed, and as a result, the auditor filed unprecedented criminal charges. Notably, though, at the court hearing on September 30th, where Dr. Kozad made his Alford plea, the The Auditor of State's office said the following. The state recognizes that Dr. Kozab was motivated to act for the benefit of the students of the school district. The state also recognizes that Dr. Kozab did not personally profit to any extent. I believe it is so very important for the community to ponder those words from the auditor. And to that end, I'm going to read them again, what the state auditor's office said. The state recognizes that Dr. Kozab was motivated to act for the benefits of the students of his school district. The state also recognizes that Dr. Kozab did not personally profit to any extent. As a board member, I view this as at most as an error owing to the lack of experience by a superintendent who had been in office for just a few months when the events surrounding this legal matter transpired. The decisions that the superintendent made in 2019 were complicated by incomplete or non-existent guidance from the Auditor of State and other agencies, and an over-reliance on examples of what other districts had used without Auditor of State complaint to communicate with their communities about proposed levies. Considering all the factors I have outlined, I personally will not propose, nor will I support any punitive personal action whatsoever against the superintendent over this legal matter that has now come to a close. It is over. It is now time to move on and allow him to continue as the superintendent of this wonderful school district, which by every measure has excelled under his leadership over the last 4 years. Again, the statement is mine alone and does not reflect the board position on this matter. Thank you.
You see, it doesn't necessarily reflect.
Correct.
Thank you very much. All right, I'm going to make a motion that we go into executive session. The board will meet in executive session for the purpose of considering the employment and compensation of a public employee per revised code 121.22, paragraph G1. Do we have a second to my motion?
Second.
Mr. Kinsey? Mr. Vine, would you please call the roll?
Mrs. Anderson?
Yes.
Mr. Carpenter?
Yes.
Mrs. Dorn?
Yes.
Mr. Kinsey?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Motion passes. We will go into executive session. We do not anticipate any action after our executive session. All right, it is 9:20 p.m. We are out of executive session. Vice President Dorn, would you like to make a statement?
I would. Since this is the first time the board has been able to meet since the proceedings on September 30th, we thought it was prudent to give the community an update as to where the board sits regarding that matter. So I'm just going to read a statement here. We recognize the members of the community are interested in the board's response to the recent resolution of the municipal court case against Superintendent Dr. Kozak and former school board member Mrs. Betts. This is a matter that the board has monitored closely since it began in November of last year. While we are pleased to finally have a resolution after months of administrative delays, this unanticipated outcome leaves us with further legal uncertainties, specifically regarding matters of legal fees and potential reimbursement. The board expected to receive the benefit of seeing evidence and hearing testimony, providing further context to aid in our decision making. And at this time, the board is seeking guidance from experts to include representatives from the state auditor's office, who both investigated and prosecuted the case, to determine what, if any, further actions are either recommended or required of the board. We feel those individuals are in the best position to explain the intent of the agreements entered into with Dr. Kozak and Mrs. Betts. Finally, this matter is not yet resolved for some current and former members of our school community. We recognize that additional pertinent information may come to light as a result of those proceedings that would provide further context and clarity. The board will continue to provide the community with updates as we learn more. So that's where we sit right now. I think that was important for us to at least share with the community where we are on that matter. That's all.
All right. Thank you very much. All right. Do we have a motion for adjournment?
So moved.
Mrs. Dorn?
Second.
Mrs. Anderson? Mr. Flanagan, please call the roll.
Mr. Carpenter?
Yes.
Mrs. Dorn?
Yes.
Mr. Kinsey?
Yes.
Mr. Price?
Yes.
Mrs. Anderson?
Yes.
Motion passes. We are adjourned at 9:22. Thank you all very much. Thank you.